Greetings from Xavier, and thanks for joining me for this week's Fireside Chat. It's good to be with you again. Over the last 2+ months, we've had an opportunity to be in conversation about a lot of terrific topics. Our response to COVID-19, consolations and desolations during these weeks, the nature of our community, our mission, our history together. I've been most grateful for the feedback and the encouragement and the support. Today, we take a turn because recent events have forced us to take a turn and to not address the killing of George Floyd, to not address the protests and police response in the aftermath of that killing would just be wrong. It's not who we are. The Second Vatican Council was really clear on the nature of church and our place in the world. Gaudium et Spes, the Constitution on the Church in the Modern World, begins. The joys and the hopes, the griefs and the anxieties of the men of this age, especially those who are poor or in any way afflicted. These are the joys and hopes, the griefs and anxieties of the followers of Christ. That's who we are, at the core of our existence. We follow Christ. We work to make the gospel real. And this is a time of fear and anxiety. It's a time of particular fear and anxiety for the poor and those in any way afflicted. So we respond. Now, I realize a turn to conversations about race and racism and the current state of events may be something that some don't want to take. I'd ask you to stay with me, right? Because I think it is a fundamental part of who we are as an institution, and this needs to be the beginning of an ongoing conversation for this community. I want to address at the start protest and policing, because often these are the things people are talking about now, and not enough time is spent talking about, well, this was sparked by the killing of George Floyd. And embedded in that killing, and the killing of Breonna Taylor and Ahmaud Arbery and others, right, are systematic issues that are not going to go away without very clear and deliberate action on our part. And while I appreciate the calls from so many to pray together, and while I appreciate standing in solidarity, I'm going to come to that in a moment. Prayer without action is going to get us nowhere. Saying, I agree with them, without action is going to get us nowhere. This moment is a call for Xavier and her sons and their families to holy boldness. This moment is a call to say, if our talk about justice is real, we need to make sure that racial justice is a constitutive part of that conversation and that work. And we need to examine our individual and our collective role in this world in which we live, in this nation in which we live. Lots of protests happening, and I want to be clear, I stand in solidarity with peaceful protest. It's a bedrock of this nation. We gather to redress the government for grievances. We have the right to assemble and to speak freely, but with that right comes a responsibility. So as strong as my solidarity is with the protesters, as strong is my condemnation of rioting and looting, and things that come from that. And if you show up with a hammer, a bat, an incendiary device to a protest, nothing good is going to come from that. And that is problematic in the extreme. Policing. I'm going to be equally clear that I stand in solidarity with law enforcement and with the NYPD. From 1PP to the local beat, we have Xavier alumni, parents, and friends working to keep the city safe working to watch out for the community writ large. And I respect that, and I'm grateful for that, and I'm in solidarity with that. But my respect for the protesters, peaceful protesters, and my respect for the NYPD does not mean any abdication of the responsibility both groups have to do the right thing. And folks who do the wrong thing should be held accountable. Ninth graders learned that at Xavier on day one. There's a reason people walk jug in that yard every day. Right? They're held to account. And those are for little things. Shirts untucked, buttons not buttoned, no belts. Right? If you can be held to account for little things, you should sure as heck be held to account for bigger things. So standing in solidarity does not mean not criticizing when criticism is justified, and does not mean holding people to account when they should be held to account. Right? Those are crucially important parts of the puzzle. But if we're only talking about protest, or we're only talking about policing, and we lose sight of the killing and deaths that triggered these protests and the response, and we lose sight of the fact that these killing and deaths are part of something bigger, something not being right. If we lose sight of structural issues in creating a just society, we're missing too much of the story, and we're letting ourselves off easy. No more letting ourselves off easy. There's a risk here. Right, there's a risk in conversation about race and racism that we say, well, you know, yeah, it's out there. We know it's out there. But it's not here at Xavier. It's, you know, it's our problem, but it's not our problem. Well, I need to dispel that. Right? That's simply not true. Right? Yes, we are a terrific school. And yes, racism and the response to racism are issues we deal with regularly. I'll give you but a few examples to make that clear. Not a year has gone by that we have not had disciplinary issues related to racist symbols, the use of the N-word, or targeting of some students by others with those symbols or words. Does it happen often? No. But does it happen almost every year in some way, shape, or form? Yeah. Right? We're not beyond that. A few years back, one of our students is arrested. Police car pulls up. Police get out. They handcuff him. He's accused of an assault, of a knockout, punching someone in the face to knock them out about a mile away from where he was at that moment. The victim identified the assailant as a black teenager wearing a gray sweatsuit. Now, I don't have to tell you, teenagers, black and white, wearing gray sweatsuits in New York City are about a dime a dozen. He didn't do it. But the fact that he said he didn't do it wasn't enough. The fact that he said I wasn't there and could point out where he was wasn't enough. And then in confusion over an appearance date, he gets further drawn into the system. This was not headed for a good ending. The student was fearful. He was innocent, and nobody believed him. And if it wasn't for one of our alums stepping up, one of our lawyers, and saying, I'll deal with this, God knows how that would have ended. And our first Peter Claver Day a few years ago, we were discussing race and racism. No sooner had the day started, right, than we got reactions. Just for discussing it. Are you saying I'm a racist? No, that's not me. No, I don't want to be part of this. Can I go home? I did just an inability to engage, a fear. Post things on social media about that. Never runs writing back. When I was at Xavier, there was no color. It's only maroon and blue. I don't see why you're talking about this. It has no place. Has no place. And that attitude negates the experience of a host of our alums and students and faculty. Right, so that sense said that this is Xavier's colorblind, that there is no, there are no race issues, there are no racism, just doesn't match the reality. And has never matched the reality. Because without deliberate work and attention, right, you can't escape this. In 67, Pedro Rupe, who was the then general of the society, most of us know him for his Man for Others address, wrote a letter to the whole society on the interracial apostolate in the United States. Right? A different version had this on the state of the Negro in America. And he challenges the society to deal directly with the issue of race and racism. And in the third section, he has a titled The Reasons for Failure. He writes, it would be a wholesome practice for each of us, individually and as members of Jesuit communities and institutions, to examine our consciences and to inquire why so little of our effort in the past has been expended in work for and with the Negro. Again, written in 67. Permit me to suggest some possible answers. A failure to appreciate fully the practical implications of the Christian concept of man, an uncritical acceptance of certain stereotypes and prejudices, the insulation of far too many Jesuits and their colleagues from the actual living conditions of the poor, an unconscious conformity to the discriminatory thought and action patterns of the surrounding community, an unarticulated fear of reprisals, and the list goes on. And it could be a list that works for today. So, race and racism, our issue, here at Xavier, and in the world in which we live. In Men for Others, Rupe asks the question, written in 1973, Rupe asks the question, have we, Jesuit schools, educated you for justice? Asking the gathered alums. You and I know that many of your teachers will answer to that question, no, we have not. If by justice and education for justice, we use the meaning the church gives them today, we have not educated you for justice. This is the general. I'd say we can ask that question now. Have we at Xavier done enough to educate about racism? Have we done enough anti-racism work? Has it been deliberate and explicit throughout the program? And the honest answer is no. The honest answer is no. We need to do more. Because we need to lead as an institution and as individuals we send forth. Dan Denehan, our board chair. Dan, many know, is a member of the class of 65, his 55th reunion year this year. Met yesterday for 3 hours. The start of our discussion was the George Floyd killing, Xavier's response. It was a great conversation. Dan and I agree on a lot of things, and there are some things on which we disagree. You know, on this issue, we agree that America is terrific and strong. And we agree that there are areas we need to grow a lot. Areas where we need to do better as a country, a lot. We agree Xavier is a great place. And there are places we need to grow. And we need to do better. And our consideration of race and our work against racism is one of those areas. Dan's about to appoint a task force to consider race and racism at Xavier. A task force that working with the Community Life and Inclusion Council and the faculty and others will take a broad view of curriculum, program, formation, faculty development, student development, saying, what can we do better? What can we do better to make sure our work for justice brings the gospel out to the world to transform it, to make sure that we don't rest on our laurels, to make sure that we don't delude ourselves into saying we're doing enough. Make sure that we're willing to answer tough questions, to look at our own sinfulness and work at reconciliation. This is the work of the task force. Because what we need to make real is the heart of who we are. In Men for Others, Arupe writes, "Today our prime educational objective must be to form men for others. Men who will not live for themselves, but for God and His Christ. For the God-man who lived and died for all the world. Men who cannot even conceive of love of God, which does not include love for the least of their neighbors. Men completely convinced that love of God, which does not issue injustice for men, is a farce." We can't be part of a farce. We need to ensure that all we do, that every way we show our love of God, issues forth injustice for man. We can do that together. We can do it better. We're called to do it better, and we will answer that call. Sons of Xavier, keep marching.